Hi, welcome to Patrick Cat's Place, my channel. I'm going to talk a bit about Elvis's music today and show a few things that I've had in the mail lately. Right now I'm playing this CD, and Memories of Elvis, Volumes 1, 2 and 3. If I sound a bit tearful and my eyes are a bit red, I've been crying. Stupid, isn't it? I'm not over my husband. But I've just received a book in today's mail, Elvis A King Forever. And it's written by a fan, from a fan's perspective, of how much he loved Elvis and how he's reacted when he died. And it just, you know, it just had an effect, profound effect on me. Anyway, so I thought, it's probably not the right day, but I'm going to do it, do a video for my channel. And my first video review is about this, now I'm lost for words, aren't I? two CD set, and it's based on, apparently they put out this first as an LP or a CD, I don't know, and it was Elvis's father, Vernon, and Colonel Parker decided, along with Joan Deary from RCA, to re-release some of Elvis's records without all the heavy backing. And it says in the little book that comes with it, Pure Elvis, it's got the list of tracks and photos of Elvis and a write-up by Vernon, I think, or Colonel, somebody at RCA. I shouldn't be doing this today, I'm so distracted, but I want to get it over and done with. Yeah, so I'll just read out what they say. When the first volume of Our Memories of Elvis was released in February 1989, it was received with great acclaim from many a diehard Elvis fans. At the time, it was considered by many fans that extensive overdubbing and subsequent sweetening of Elvis' 70s arrangements detracted from the overall clarity of voice and instrumentation. In essence, the intimacy and dynamic of both song and performance was somehow lost in the mix. Therefore, when RCA executive Joan Deary devised the Pure Elvis concept, it was greeted with great enthusiasm. For Deary, it served as an opportunity to rectify what she had felt had been wrong with Elvis's 70s productions. And it goes on to say, ironically, it's doubtful if Elvis himself would have approved the treatment, because, as we all know, Elvis really loved the orchestra and the big band sound and the groups behind him. But I must admit, over a period of time, I've sometimes thought, gee, I'd just like to hear Elvis's voice as it was in the beginning in the 50s, with just Scotty Bill and DJ behind him, and the Jordanaires. Now, the Jordanaires were terrific. I thought they enhanced Elvis's voice. As good as J.D. Sumner and the Stamps and the Sweet Inspirations were, I felt that they drowned him out. I mean, when you saw Elvis in concert in person, nothing drowned Elvis out. His voice was so powerful. Maybe he had speakers and the microphones rigged up to do that, but nothing could drown him out. But on his records, sometimes you struggle to hear Elvis's voice. So, the less is more view was certainly in line with Colonel Parker's view. Who, as far back as King Creole and the Dune 58 sessions, had complained that Elvis couldn't be heard properly over all the instruments. For this reason, he wholeheartedly embraced Joan's new concept, Our Memories of Elvis, that stripped carefully chosen songs back to basics. Both Elvis's father, Vernon, and the Colonel gave their consent and even endorsed the project by having their photo adorn the cover art, which was that one I just showed you. Anyway, so there was two records put out, and then there was a third one, let me see. There was disc one, disc two. Now the disc one, let me see. Disc one, volume one and volume two. Oh, sorry, I'm talking about the discs in this set. There was volume one of Our Memories of Elvis with I Used to See Her, It's Midnight, My Boy, Girl of Mine, Take Good Care of Her, I'll Never Fall in Love Again, Your Love's Been a Long Time Coming, Spanish Eyes, Never Again, She Thinks I Still Care, and Solitaire. That was apparently the first record. Then Volume 2 came out, and it had on it, I've Got a Feel in My Body, Green Green Grass of Home, For the Heart, She Wears My Ring, I Can Help, Way Down, There's a Honky Tonk Angel, Find Out What's Happening, Thinking About You, Don't Think Twice, It's All Right. Okay, so they were the first two. And then, where are we? I'll go back here. With sales of 200,000 volume 1 and 150,000 volume 2 copies in the US, the series certainly made financial sense, RCA. Despite the healthy sales, the records didn't have true mass appeal. So respectively, volume 3 had been prepared by Deary, but it was shelved as other projects materialised that had more mainstream commercial potential. This extended package includes the original albums, the unreleased volume 3, and several extra tracks that were mixed but not used for the third volume. So the volume 3, unreleased, includes Woman Without Love, Moody Blue, When I'm Over You, It's a Matter of Time, Sweet Angeline, Hurt, Shake a Hand, Promised Land, Heart of Rome, If You Don't Come Back. And the bonus material previously unreleased, Mr. Songman, For Old Time's Sake, Love Coming Down, Pledging My Love, Raised on Rock, The Last Farewell, and Fool. I had played the first disc a while ago when I first got this, but I didn't play the second one until last night. And I tell you what, it just blew me away. Especially with The Last Farewell and Fool and Hurt, which have long been some of my favourite songs. And to hear his voice, as I said, pure Elvis without all the backing. If you haven't already got this set, I urge you to get it because it's great listening. It's absolutely fantastic. I'm just going to check my camera. I think it's moved. No, it hadn't. Just seems to be facing in the wrong direction. Okay, so that's it. As I said, this is the gatefold of the CD. One record is in there, and it's got the little booklet that goes inside the cover like so. So I'm playing that in the background now. You probably can't hear it, but as I said, beautiful, beautiful set. Next one I want to talk about is volume 6, I think, of the Essential Elvis. This one is Such a Night. Again, I wasn't sort of enamoured of getting re-releases and re-outtakes of Elvis's songs, but I've become addicted. Thank you, YouTube. And all the people that play these songs, and especially the EAP Society, who go through all these records in fine detail. The little booklet, very little booklet. Yeah, that's just got all the songs that are on it. Again, worth having because of the variations in the songs from the original records. Yeah. Then I've got volume 2 of the Essential Elvis, which is Elvis Presley Stereo 57. This is a little booklet that comes with it. So, I don't know whether I've done this before, I don't think so. But I love the photo on the front. And then it's just got information about the songs, it's got more photos. Information about it. Just in case you don't know what's on it, that's visible for you to see. Then we have Elvis Way Down in the Jungle Room, which again I think I mentioned earlier that I got. It's another gatefold one. The CDs. It's got a lot of songs. It's got 1630. I'm not going to read them all out loud. And it's also got a little booklet that comes with it. And I've been reading. There's so much about Elvis that I didn't know. I guess it flies to a lot of us, doesn't it? The reason why this jungle room session, the reason why he got sick of recording in the studios, and there's so much going on in his life, obviously, and one of the things this book mentions too, that why Elvis threw himself into all the concerts toward the end of his life, touring around Las Vegas, because he wanted his fans, maybe he had a feeling that because of his health problems, he wasn't going to be around much longer, and he wanted his fans, as many as possible, to see him. But, it just makes me cheerful again thinking about that. What a man. So, yeah, that's a great little book in this set. And again, information about the songs. Pull off those CDs. Oh yeah. Okay. Getting a lot of pleasure listening to these CDs and records. Stuff that I haven't been aware of for many years. Okay, Scotty Moore, Right Hand of the King. I only received this the other day. I was playing it. It is absolutely brilliant CD. It's mostly Elvis, but it's all really about Scotty. Scotty Moore, Right Hand of the King. And it's got photos and information about the various the records that he did. And it's got also quotes by other people, such as Keith Richard from the Rolling Stones. When I heard Heartbreak Hotel, I knew what I wanted to do. It was plain as day. All I wanted to do in the world was to be able to play guitar and sound like that. Everybody else wanted to be Elvis. I wanted to be Scotty. And then it's got quite a good write-up about Scotty, things he said, what other people said about him. Hard sitting this way, isn't it? Knocking the table too, which doesn't help things. Lots of photos, lots of information. I hate it when they print on dark coloured paper. My eyesight isn't the best, the cataract's oncoming, so. But doesn't help me. I just get the magnifying glass out, so it's no use putting this up close to the camera because you won't be able to read it either. Okay. I will just read out what songs are on this because it's... Well, okay, now there's 30. Okay, that's all right, Mama, good rockin' tonight. Pretty much all the Elvis, early Elvis songs, going up to Jailhouse Rock, Don't Be Cruel, and all the ones that the guys, Scotty Moore and Bill Black, were used. Their backing was used in the music. There's also a couple of early ones that Scotty Moore Trio, Have Guitar Will Travel, and Now She Cares No More, Doug Pendexter and the Starlight Wranglers, and My Kind of Carrying On, again by Doug Pendexter and the Starlight Wranglers. Okay, and then they're pretty much Elvis, and nearly all of it is Elvis's early stuff, but right up to Frankfurt Special and Knight Rider. Little Sister, I mean, I just love the guitar work on Little Sister. So it's on the credits, Scotty Moore lead guitar with Elvis Presley, lead vocals, acoustic guitar and piano. Bill Black, bass, Marvin Hughes, Gordon Stoker, piano, DJ Fontana, drums, the Jordanaires backing vocals, among others. Recorded in Memphis, Nashville, Hollywood and New York between 1954 and 1962. So it's worth having. Okay, the Elvis ones I've all heard before, but yeah, that's just something special the way he's got them arranged. this one, Elvis Presley, the Hayride 55, the Hayride Show 55. I was playing that, I think, on my previous video. They're the songs that are on it. Very, very, very early Elvis, you know, and in that, those early days, he really sounded nothing like what he sounded later on. But that's okay. Now, there is a little pressure in there too, I think, right? Yeah. Oh, no, it's just, no. It's not, oops. It's not a leaflet. It's not a little booklet. It's just a cover. Okay. CDs. Now, I've bought 3 DVDs lately. Elvis, A Generous Heart. Which, no booklet, just the CD with it. I'd played, it's, hang on, let me see which one. I'm trying to think whether if, oh yeah, the DVD, this is just 1 DVD, that's okay. I'm getting mixed up with all what I've been watching lately. Elvis is without a doubt, the most beloved, idolised, legendary star in history. Through his music, live performance and his films, he brought joy to millions of people around the world. But for all his accomplishments as an entertainer, perhaps his greatest legacy was his enormous generosity. This DVD, Elvis Generous Heart, examines his wonderful gift or legacy of generosity. I've got a feeling I might have talked about this on a previous video. I'm sorry if I have, but I had it sitting in the lounge room with all my other stuff that I wanted to talk about. So, sorry if I've doubled up. Okay. This one, the Elvis Files, I don't recommend this. It's a fascinating documentary to discuss the mysterious details surrounding the death of Elvis and poses the intriguing question, is he still alive? Based on the book by Gail Brewer Giorgio, it features a combination of rare footage, exclusive audio and personal interviews to support Brewer's theory that Elvis's death was a staged hoax designed to save his life. Well, I've got to tell you, I'd like to swear, but I think that it's absolute, utter bulldust. Too many people that were close to Elvis, including his daughter, his girlfriends, his friends that were living, his father, they saw Elvis dead on the bathroom floor. How can anybody possibly say something like this? As much as you might want Elvis to be alive, he died. And he died in horrific circumstances, I think, to die alone, probably in pain. And to insult the people that were closest to him and loved him the most to say, you didn't see him dead, what you saw was a hoax. I don't recommend that, and I reckon it should be taken off the market. Okay, this one, Elvis the Missing Years, is a combination, it's a DVD. DVD rare footage showing the private man behind the icon, plus a 55-minute audio documentary, and also an audio CD, his early music, plus rare interviews from his time in the army. It's all going well. Oh, so you've got DVD and a CD. It's all going well. I was listening to him think what a great thing it was until the commentator said toward the last, he made a comment. He said, Elvis's death caused by overdose of drugs and alcohol. And it lost me. I thought, oh God. So, I don't know. Yeah, look, I can recommend it because it's, I'm pretty sure that's the one I was listening to last night. Yeah. Sure it is. Yeah, okay, get mixed up. I'm sure it was that one or not this one. Yeah. But that makes me so mad when you get something that's such a good documentary, great photos, the whole lot, and then they spoil it by saying something completely wrong. So, yep, mixed feelings a lot. But yeah, it's worth having because of the photos and stuff in Germany. Complex the recordings. The CD features 1954 recordings by Elvis and the Blue Moon Boys, Maybelline, That's All Right Mama, Blue Moon of Kentucky, and so on. Yep. So, okay, fine. That is what it is. All right, well, I'll get those out of the way and show you some of the books. Some of the books that I've got to show you are big and unwieldy, and I'm not going to be able to hold them up. But these ones aren't that bad. Now, the guy who sent me these two books in the mail today, guy in New South Wales, Australia, very kindly sent me some extras. They are the books. And he also sent me these beautiful photos, just as an extra, just because I'm an Elvis fan. That one. That one. Oops. That one. And this 2003 calendar. So thank you, mate. If you're watching, I appreciate that. Now this book, the illustrated biography of Elvis. Beautiful book. And what I might do is actually pick up the camera, bring it around, open it up and focus on it. Because, like I said, they're too heavy. And this is the book that had me in tears earlier today. And I also want to show you the one I received yesterday, the Paperdoll book. So we'll pick this up and we'll move everything around. And spread them out. Okay. First of all, the Elvis Paperdoll book. I've heard of this, and I was really pleased to get it on eBay. The thing is, you can cut out those pop out, but when it comes to the clothes, behind each lot of clothes is actually a picture of Elvis. So I reckon there's probably a lot of these cut out, these doll books or paper doll books that haven't ever been cut out because you don't want to cut the pictures up behind the clothing. So you've got Rockabilly Cat, On the Road, the Dallas Concert, Jam Session. So you go from early Elvis, Steve Allen Show, Ed Sullivan Show, where are we? Elvis the Kid? Oh well, yeah. And Love Me Tender. And again, pictures which I would never want to cut. The only way I can see if I wanted to actually play with my paper dolls is scan them on a computer and do printouts of the clothing and cut them out from there. Look at those fans. Look at the fans. Wow. And Priscilla's clothes, although that don't interest me. Army. More of Priscilla's clothes. Germany. Oh, Germany, I suppose, yeah. That was his uniform. And then you've got photos of Elvis, Germany, Vernon. Okay, then we've got movies. Kid Galahad, Viva Las Vegas, Harum Scarum, and Charo. More pictures. It's just a montage, you know, made up of various photos, but they're nice. I really like them. I want to cut them up. Little Boy, Elvis and Priscilla. And then the singer, the later years, the singer special, the leather outfit, comeback, Las Vegas, more of Las Vegas. And then, okay, photos, karate outfit, and Elvis the American. And finally, two more cutouts of Elvis. So that's why the costumes have got different start again. You've got him jumping around and then you've got him like so, and then for that, and then for those outfits he would use one of these where he's actually standing still. So I'm tickled pink to have it. Like I said, I might one day do some photocopies on my computer of those, same size, cut them out, and then use them to dress up the cut-out dolls. Okay. This book, I hadn't heard anything about it, didn't know anything about it. I've been seeing it on eBay, and finally just said, oh, what the heck, I'll get it. And I'll leaf through it. Written by a fan, Robert Gibson. And at first glance, you might think, okay, you know, same old, yep, terrific. A lot of the, you know, photos seen before and the write-up about Elvis's life. But this guy, the way he writes, I'm going to clap in, going close. I don't know if you can read that or not. But he writes a lot about the impact that Elvis had on the world and individuals, fans and so on. The impact of his life was devastating, just as devastating was his death. Wherever you were, it was the same. Whatever the time, it stood still. Whatever you were doing, you stopped. Whatever concerned you no longer seemed to matter. Elvis Presley was dead. It meant so much more than the death of a pop star, a rock star, idol. It was the death of an age. Youth promises immortality to each new generation. It is a promise that is always believed but never kept. It somehow seemed that it would never end, but it did. On 16th of August, it was on that day that a whole generation came face to face with Elvis, with mortality. For if death was no respecter of legends and kings, it could be no respecter of people. Yeah. He goes on to say, a trip to Memphis, a party of devotees from the Elvis Yours fan club of Great Britain. The personal tributes that helped to explain what made Elvis the phenomenon he was and still is. And then it goes on, interviewing or talking to different people about, you know, how they felt about Elvis. See, another lad, just 19, his hair dyed black and swept back like a young Elvis, said, Elvis has been many things to me throughout my life. When I was a kid, my father left home. To me, then Elvis became a father. As I grew older, in my early teens, he became more of an older brother. Now he is my friend. An old lady of 70 who decided to see Memphis before she died said, I see him as a son, someone who is always there. The walls of my flat are plastered with his pictures. I turn his music on and I don't feel lonely anymore. He has transcended mere superstardom. He is a superhuman, supernatural hold upon his fans that will never be challenged by any other form or personality. Elvis fans say they never feel a gnawing, empty loneliness so often experienced by others. He is always there, they say, a guide, a mentor, a comfort, a friend. He may have started as a sex symbol and may have remained one, but it is as all these things that he is remembered. Okay. I stood at the kitchen table. I actually stood. I didn't even sit down. I stood and read this book through. I think I stopped to go and hang the washing out. It was so well written. So well written. About his early years.
There is solitaire
That's the outfit and the paper doll outfit book that I just can't forget. There's memorabilia. Writes about Elvis' early days. And an interesting thing that I've, a lot of rubbish and stuff has been written about Colonel Parker and his influence on Elvis and how he ripped Elvis away from Sam Phillips and Bob Neill. Well, you know, there's a lot of books and information, but I think this guy, this author, has got it right. He came along, he was just right for Elvis at the right time. Elvis's manager, Bob Neill, had been having problems keeping up with Elvis at the time and had often turned to Colonel Parker to help with bookings further afield. Bob said he'd gotten so big it meant I would have to give up everything to go with him. Bob had a wife, bought five children and a job as a DJ, a way of life he loved. He knew that staying with Elvis would mean giving up some of that, if not the lot. I needed more time with my family. Elvis needed someone who would devote every moment of his time. So that's when Bob introduced Elvis to Colonel Parker. And the same with Sam Phillips, where Sam was in the same situation. Elvis was becoming too big to handle. Not only that, but Sam needed money to develop some of the new talent he'd uncovered. So, it benefited everybody in the long run. Oh, I think this bloke, has got a lot of things right, but a lot of other people twist or, put in a negative context, which doesn't need to be. The other films. It's an unusual one, isn't it? That's in Love Me Tender, with a cameraman. And that's another thing that's come up in some of the stuff I've been reading and watching about when Elvis was in the army. A fierce loyalty that the other guys in the unit had for him. I think it was because they sensed he was a regular guy. He sat in the snow with them, ate the lousy food, and the fact that he lived off the post and commuted in a fancy car didn't bother them. He would always get a lot of packages filled with cake and candy, more than he could eat, and give it away. The other soldiers thought a lot of him. I couldn't imagine anybody not liking Elvis. It's stupid, isn't it? You don't know. I've never met the girl. Here I am on the other side of the world, and yet, like so many of his fans, I felt like I knew him. And as bad as some people say his films were, to me, the real Elvis, he always seemed to shine out. The smile on his face, his eyes, the way he spoke. He might not have liked his films, and other people might not, but somehow, I just think underneath it you could see the real person, the nice guy, the decent, loving, compassionate person that he was. Okay, just picking out a bit here. The guys that made the movie or the documentary, That's the Way It Is. Let's see. I found it difficult to take the cameras off him and focus on other aspects of the show. It's difficult to take your eyes off it. Elvis is magic, that's the word for it. He just pulls people in. He's a real, genuine, warm human being. He's friendly, he loves people. And I guess that must be the key to it. The people who are watching in the audience, they just feel that. Couldn't be better said. Memorabilia. There's things here. On a drilling rig. Far out the North Sea, an oil worker gazed unseeingly into the blackness, dreaming of home. Another man approached him and quietly murmured a few words. The first man's... The first man turned his eyes, bright with fury. He kept his cool, but his voice was ice cold. If you ever say that to me again, even as a joke, I'll tear you apart. The other man was shaken, as shocked by his news as the reaction it evoked. It's true. I wouldn't joke. Not about something like this. Within a few minutes, the first man had broken down. He was in hysterics, uncontrollable, inconsolable. Within an hour, a helicopter had been flown from the mainland to the oil rig. To take him off. His behaviour was considered a danger to the safety of the rig. In St. Louis, a young woman heard the news. She'd been saving hard, looking forward to the day when she'd marry her sweetheart, saving for the future. Suddenly, the future didn't seem to matter. She leapt into her car, drove to the bank, withdrew every cent she had, and caught the next plane to Memphis. As the news came through on radio stations all over the world, people stopped what they were doing. The moment froze forever in memory. Bullet radio and television programs are interrupted with the news. The programs are abandoned altogether, and the airtime given over completely to music, his music. Rock and roll, the music of life. And as the world still waited to be told it was not true, the impossible, the unthinkable, the unbearable had not really happened. The newspapers in cold black and white, indelible and undeniable, hit the streets in a thousand cities. Elvis is dead. In a moment scarred, in a million memories, the moment they learned that Elvis Presley was dead. Only the death of assassinated American President John F. Kennedy is as brutally branded upon the public consciousness. Elvis was dead, and something of the world died with him. Anyway, our battery's just... camera's just about out of battery. Sorry, this is not the best video I've ever made, that's for sure. Probably the worst. Yeah, but I'll stick it on. I know. Yeah. Okay, Robert Gibson is a lifelong Elvis fan. After many years as a leading staff writer on the Daily Star, he currently holds a position of political correspondent on the paper. Sid Shaw is managing director of Elvis the Yours, Europe's biggest supplier of Presleyana. The photographs he supplied for this book are from private collections. So I think this was published in... Oops. So how many years ago is that? 85. 40 years later. And I won't say it's my favourite book, but by God, it had an effect on me when I read it today. Bye for now.